sacrifice for us so that we can have a relationship with you, God. Continue to lead us in worship this morning as we draw into what you're going to teach us today, you've been us, and as we gather to this morning. Amen. I guess we'll take a seat. If you are new with us this morning, I invite you to fill out our connection tab in the bulletin. Just some basic information we'd like you to fill out and drop in that offer basket or in the connection counter on your way out this morning.
I'd like to draw your attention to our hot sheet, which is the first page pertaining to the majority of us. A few things I want to make note of. This Saturday night, our laughter and love event. first, thanks for that, Todd. That's our Emmanuel boys tennis team, and we had a great weekend. We won our division, and it was a fun time hanging out with those guys and watching them win. So, there it is. Now, this Saturday, Laughter and Love event coming up for all of us, and particularly for those of you who have significant others. This is a free, it's a cheap date this Saturday night if you're interested. Tickets are $10. And it includes free entertainment from Jim Adams, and dessert is also included in that. So you can buy your tickets today in the connection counter, and today is the last day to purchase those. So stop by at our connection counter in the foyer if you're interested. Our Kingdom Kids program will be this evening in the sanctuary at 5 o'clock. If you're interested in coming to that and listening to what these kids have practiced these past 8 weeks and getting ready for a performance to share with you guys this evening if you're interested. And that is free. So come back tonight if you're interested. It's been so cool to see kids come to know Jesus through this Kingdom Kids ministry. We have another kid who accepted Christ this week, and we have a balloon over there to celebrate that. So can we praise God? The last thing I want to celebrate together is we had a birth this week to the family of Matt and Kaylee Martins, and they had a kid whose name is, I'm good at this, Lucy Kate Martins. So, and we have a rose on the organ to celebrate that, so we praise God for that. Oh, Randy, why don't you continue to lead us in worship this morning?
Thanks, Kevin. I appreciate it. That's good stuff. This morning, choir, would you stand? We want to read together about our wonderful, merciful Savior. I've been thinking about that this week, singing this song and thinking about what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. What a merciful and wonderful Savior He is. And we invite Him to speak to us today, don't we? Wouldn't it be awesome to hear from the Lord what He wants to say to us this morning? So just during this song, maybe you want to sing with us. And then as we continue after that, may His presence fill this place. Let's read together Psalm 115, verse 1. Say it together. Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name goes all the glory for your unfailing love and faithfulness. And then Ephesians 2, 4 through 5. But God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you've been saved. It is only by God's grace that we've been saved. Let's sing that together. together.
Join with me in prayer as we continue to worship the Lord, continue to be in His presence this morning. Father, indeed, we do long to be in Your presence. We long to know the joy of Your presence. We long to know and to be surrounded in the grace of Your presence, the mercy that exudes from You. Reminded, Father, of Your word, says that I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord and let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord and He answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to Him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. And Father, I pray that that is our prayer as Your people this morning, that we would exalt You, we would extol Your virtues, we would speak praise, Father, of Your name and of all the things that You have done for us, all the things that You do for Your people. Father, that we would be willing to let those who are suffering and hurting today, to remind them again of Your great truths, that their hearts may be encouraged and strengthened to continue to follow after You. And Father, I know that in this room, there are those who are struggling. There are those who need that encouragement. There are those, Father, whom You have been working powerfully in their lives that could be speaking into the lives of others. So I pray that You would open our eyes to be able to see those opportunities and give us the boldness to take those opportunities and to extol Your praise to others. Father, what a great reminder it is as well to know that when we seek You, we will find You. And that when we pray to You, You answer us. and that you will deliver us from our fears. You will deliver us from our anxieties. You will send your perfect peace, that peace that we are told that passes all understanding, that will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And I pray, Father, again, that for us here today, we would seek you out. And we would seek to see our fears and our anxieties, the things of the unknown, that we would seek to see them set aside and to fix our eyes upon you, to fix our eyes upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we want to pray for Josiah and Crystal this morning. We thank you for the opportunity that we had to be with them a few weeks ago, and we thank you for the ministry that you are doing through them. We pray, Father, along with them, and as Josiah was even saying, we pray for his health. We pray that you would continue to strengthen him and continue to give him healing. And Father, we also want to stand with him and stand with his family and just asking your blessing over them. And Father, we thank you for the ministry that you have given him to our Hispanic brothers and sisters that are going and preaching the gospel in their churches. And Father, we ask that you would give wisdom and insight to Josiah as he not only preaches in Spanish, but as he is teaching and is writing curriculum in Spanish. And I pray, Father, that you would supernaturally be working in him to enable him to understand the language more deeply, to be able to communicate your truths more clearly so that our brothers and sisters in Christ, as they are reading that and learning and applying the theological principles and just the mechanics of ministry to their lives, that they would be able to understand it in their language as well. And we thank you for the partnership that we are able to share with Josiah and Crystal and their family. And Father, now as we come to you to continue to worship by the giving back of our tithes and our offerings, we ask that you would indeed add your blessing to them. And Father, that you would be glorified through all that we give, all that we do, and that the name of Jesus Christ would be lifted up, that he would be the preeminent one. And Father, that we would take not only the giving of these tithes and these offerings, but we would take the giving of our very lives to be given to your kingdom and to your work. And Father, may you be glorified and praised through all of this. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. We praised Him today. Thank you, music department, choir, Randy, Steve, for guiding us in worship today. It's great. Why don't you come join us as we open the Word of God? Our children are on their way to Children's Church, and I invite you to stand and greet someone around you. Sorry. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. So good to have all of you here. And if you're a guest, especially extend a welcome to you. I want to welcome those who are watching us via our simulcast, whether you're at Palm Village or somewhere else on vacation. We're so glad that you're tuning in and you can be with us too. I've met a number of our students this week who are home on spring break from college. And we have a group that drove straight through just to be here today from Manhattan Bible College in Manhattan, Kansas. And welcome, students. It's great to have you here. If you're a guest this morning, just want to remind you that there are various ways that we try to help you learn. From week to week, there is a sermon text that a lot of people pick up because some people, they learn better by, they learn visually. They have to see something, and so we have the screens going. Those are visual learners. There are other people who just like to sit there, and because you learn better by listening, you are auditory learners. There are those who are better at learning by reading themselves. You need to see it, think it. I think you're called cognitive learners. Then there are those of you who are here that learn best. You need to do something, and we call you men. We hope that you have something to do during the service as well. That's why you have the notes in the bulletin, so that you can fill something in and do something as you learn. But may God guide us. As we find our text this morning in 1 Corinthians 6, 12, we're continuing on in this study of a great letter written to an amazing place back in the first century in Corinth. I want you to start at the end of our text for just a few moments to set the basis for how we want to learn and how we want to understand what God wants to teach us from a very specific text this morning. So if you'd look at the last phrase, it says, this is 1 Corinthians 6, 20 says, therefore, honor God with your body. I don't particularly like talking about my body or yours, but it's in the text. And so we have to address that this morning. So if you're ready to learn with me about that, I want you to move one phrase previous as well, or maybe two it should be, at the end of verse 19 where it says, you are not your own. And I believe that is the key that can unlock this text for us this morning if we will embrace that idea. Would you turn to the person next to you and say, you're not your own. You're not your own. Try to keep that in mind because and the depth to which we embrace that idea and believe it is the degree to which we'll be able to understand and personalize this text, this what God is teaching us here. Until we believe that there is the creator of the universe who has created our bodies, we are not our own, we owe everything to Him. Until we really embrace that idea, what we're going to learn this morning, what we're going to read is going to seem, for one, out of touch with current thinking. It's going to seem outdated. It's going to be a little bit offensive. And it'll definitely be politically incorrect. But once we embrace the fact that we are not our own, we belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, then what we're talking about here, what Paul is teaching those people and us about our bodies, and when I use that word this morning, try to think with me that it's more than just a physical body. It's a body that's made up of a mind and a heart with passions and desires and thoughts and feelings and emotions. And it's the total person, but it is the body. Something very real about that. Let's read this text and you'll understand why, I hope you'll understand why I began this way. Because it is very specific and it causes us, it invites us to think about some things that are very relevant to life as we know it today. Paul writes, verse 12, "Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me," he repeats himself, "but I will be mastered. I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and the stomach for food, but God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. But His power, by His power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and He will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ Himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said the two will become one flesh. But he who unites himself with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body." We live in an amazing time. I'm so glad to be alive these days when we get to witness and experience the blessings of scientific discoveries, medical science, and the combination of that with all kinds of technology that enables us to do things with and to our bodies that before were unimaginable in terms of laser surgeries and non-invasive kinds of procedures and things that just help us live long lives and live quality lives. But in addition to that, there is this continual infatuation with our appearance. It's part of living in our culture, I think maybe more than any other culture, the Western society is just infatuated with how we look. And so there are multi-billion dollar industries around cosmetics and diets and health foods and exercise and fashion. And you just go on from there. It's everywhere. And underneath that is an unquenchable, it seems, appetite for everything that has to do with sexuality. You see, if you put that all together, you have a picture of the world in which we live. A world that's not unlike the world in which the Corinthians were living, and that's why Paul was able to write this very practical teaching to them. Let me say a couple more things about this by way of background before we look at the text. I want you to remember that in Corinth there was a Greek culture that looked at the body in what I would say was a confused way. If you think people are confused about body and gender today, they were confused back then as well. Particularly it had to do with the fact that they approached life in such a stoical manner. And so they couldn't figure out if the body really mattered or not. For many people, the body was something that's very neutral. The soul was real, but the body was just kind of a carrier for the spirit. And on the other hand, people thought even worse. They thought that the body was kind of evil, that our souls were kind of trapped in this human body. And so the result was they went in two directions in terms of how to live. On the one hand, there were those who felt like you needed to beat your body into submission. And so they did all kind of things to themselves physically and tried to say, "I'm in control. My body is not going to tell me what to do." But on the other hand, people said, well, since the body is kind of neutral, and the soul is the only thing that's real, I can do whatever I please with my body. And so there was this life of what I call license, just doing living life without any restraints. And so we meet this little band of believers in Corinth who are trying to figure out, how do we live in this kind of confused culture? See, I've told you before that Corinth was like Sin City today in America. It was the capital of the sex industry of that day. On a hill about 2,000 feet above the city was an Acropolis, where there was a temple to Aphrodite, the goddess of love. It wasn't always this way, but at one point in the history of Corinth, there were 1,000 prostitutes that lived in that temple. And in the evenings, they would come down and they would wander through the streets of Corinth. Can you imagine what life was like in Corinth in that day? The result, however, was that the Christians, too, were not totally agreed on what they should do about that. There were some who had heard Paul teach about Christian liberty, and they said, well, let's enjoy the city. When we go to Las Vegas, let's just enjoy the strip and everything that's a part of it, because we have freedom in Christ. And then there was others who said, no, there are limits to what God would have us to do. Those things are prohibited and we should not participate in any of that in any kind of any fashion. And so I believe Paul is writing to bring a balance to two extremes, not only in the culture, but in the Christian community as well. And isn't that the world in which we live? Isn't that our struggle as well? That even here among us, we don't always agree on what are our limits and what are our boundaries. So I want to talk to you for a little bit about the opening statements that Paul gives us here as he describes the limit, the freedom that we have in Christ, the liberty. But he reminds us that liberty in Christ and all kinds of true liberty requires some kind of limits. And in the midst of that, we need to be careful that we don't practice what's called license, just pursuing our desires without any limits at all. So those are the three things. And Todd, you might want to just put those three things on the screens right now. Facing our liberty, facing our limits, and facing our license, or standing against the problem of license. I want you to note that the first line that Paul gives us here is in quotations, and I believe that is because it was a saying that was going around Corinth and maybe even in the church at that time. All things are permissible. And Paul generally agreed with that. He had taught them about Christian liberty. But it seems like the people had heard the first part of his sentence and the statement, but they hadn't heard what he had taught after that. Yes, all things are permissible, but he says not all things are beneficial. In fact, he says all things are permissible, but I will not be mastered by anything. So Paul, in essence, is saying while we have great liberty in Christ, there are some things that not only are not beneficial, I think he would want to say they're actually destructive. He says there are some things that are maybe beneficial, but they are actually very, very enslaving. Or today we would use the term, they're very addictive. And if they're that addictive, they could be destructive. And so Paul wants us to know that we have a great measure of freedom in Christ, but freedom requires certain kind of limits and boundaries. His teaching is an important truth here about how we understand sin as God has described it. Because it's a great day when we finally discover personally that God does not call something evil because it's sin, if I can say this correctly. Things are not evil simply because God calls them sin. God names things sin and sinful because God understands how evil they are, or how destructive they are, or how addictive they can be. And so when we learn to trust God on that, we understand that He is giving us limits for our benefits and for our safety. And He doesn't have this top 10 list of sins necessarily, but rather He loves us and He names things as sin because He knows if we go past this boundary, this level, this limit, He knows what can happen in our lives. He loves us too much not to tell us what will eventually lead to our ruin, our destruction, our enslavement in something that He originally freed us from when He gave us freedom from sin and freedom in Christ Jesus. God helps us set limits. There's another quote right after that in these opening lines, which is, "Food for the stomach and the stomach for food." In Corinth, if the saying was, if you're hungry, go get something to eat. There's plenty of places to do that. But the Corinthians weren't stopping at that level, talking about food. They took it into other areas of our life. They evidently said the same thing about their sexual appetites. If you have an appetite, feed it. Doesn't matter necessarily what it is. And Paul's response to that way of thinking forms the rest of this paragraph here that we're studying this morning, not the the rest of this chapter. See, what he gives us is something that we really wouldn't know if God didn't tell us. Well, we might be able to figure some of it out by deduction. You know, we figure like, you know, well, I've done this so many times and it isn't working out very good for me. You know, in our recovery ministries that we carry out here in church, we have a definition of insanity. And it goes like this. Insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. We kind of chuckle about that, but don't we do that sometimes? We keep doing the same thing. We do it habitually and we become enslaved to it. And we wonder, why am I not getting different results? Why am I not feeling better? And so God helps us with that. And Paul is speaking here about something that is in the area of what we call license. Just doing as you please. Do you realize that Christianity, of all the world religions, is primarily the only one that teaches that matter matters. That our bodies are something that created by God. What we do with them matter to Him. And almost every other world religion, I'm talking particularly about non-Christian religions, there's this amazing confusion about bodies. And so people are always trying to, you know, they're either worshiping their body or they're denigrating it and putting it down. What we do with our bodies, with Paul's conclusion, matters to God. Why is that? Why does it matter to God? Well, that's what he's teaching us now in verses 13 to the end of the chapter. And I want to just lay that out for you. Three reasons why what we do with our bodies, and that includes our emotions, of course, and our desires and our thoughts, but particularly with our bodies, he's talking about something very physical and sexual as well. Why does that matter? The first reason is that there is an eternal purpose, an eternal quality to our bodies because God is the creator. That's what he's teaching. And if you look at verses 13 and 14 for a moment. Now, this would have been a radical idea for the Corinthians, at least for those who had this Greek mentality in them, because for them, they felt like when you died, it was just done. Your body was, it was over, nothing more. And Paul gives us the other view of that. He says we're not to worship our bodies, no. But to realize that God, as creator, places great value on our bodies, on all of us. And that includes you and me as well. Well, don't look around right now, but boy, do we come in different shapes and sizes, don't we? And God has made us so uniquely, each one of us, with various capacities, and to think that God loves what He has created. Now, the body that will be raised, Paul talks here about the resurrection, saying that just as Christ was raised from the dead, so we will be raised. So that's the eternal purpose that we have with our physical bodies. Of course, the body that will be raised is going to be different than the one that we have now. Paul teaches in chapter 15, which we'll come to much later, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. The mortal must put on immortality. But there is going to be a literal, real resurrection. I believe in that. I proclaim that, and it's what gives us so much hope when we are at the grave of someone who is a believer, to know that God is going to raise that person once again, that we'll have a new life that's going to be different, But I believe we're going to recognize one another. And part of life here is practicing what we're going to be doing in heaven, which is worshiping God and serving Him. That's going to be eternity and it's going to be glorious. And so why not do that in a way during this life that is honoring to God? Paul says, honor God with your body because there is an eternal value, an eternal purpose and perspective to your very physical body. Secondly, he says, not only that, there is a divine possession of your body. You have been indwelt by the presence of God through His Holy Spirit. God lives in you. What an amazing thought. What an idea that we don't think about deeply enough, I'm afraid. To realize that every day as I'm walking around, I'm a one who carries within me, in my spirit, the presence of the living God. The Holy Spirit has come and taken up residence in me. Here's some things that Paul says. Your bodies are members of Christ Himself. Do you realize what an amazing truth that is? Your bodies are members of Christ Himself. Unite with the Lord and you are one with Him in spirit. And that can give us a purpose and a reason for living every day. And it can shape how we choose to honor God with our bodies. That's the call here. There's a second thing about this in this section that talks about the fact that God has come to live in us. Paul uses the same word here for uniting with Christ as God used throughout the Bible when he talks about husband and wife being united to one another. It's a word for glue. And when we glue something together, there is a chemical reaction that takes place. So there is a penetration of the particles of those two things that they become one. And to separate one from the other means that you leave part of yourself behind. Our physical union in marriage is deeper than any other encounter that we know that we can have in our lives. There's this uniting, a joining of persons. And consistently, the Word of God says, the two shall be united and they shall become one. See, this is, friends, something that people have been trying to dispute or deny for generations in this movement that we have in our culture, in America, towards free sex and free love. People think that they can park their soul in the garage with their car and that nothing has nothing to do with what they do in the bedroom. And God says, it cannot work that way. I'm the Creator. I designed you for sexual pleasure, but you can't separate out who you are in your deepest recesses of your being, your soul and your spirit, from your body. It doesn't work that way. So we can imagine what the next generation is going to inherit when now for the first time in the history of our nation, listen to this, most people, I didn't just say more people, most people either live together or sleep together before they're married. And God says, that is not my design. I didn't design you that way. You can't do that without having some implications for the very inner recess of who you are, your inner being. God's divine possession and plan stands today. It's holy. So we honor God with our bodies because of this eternal purpose, this eternal part, this dimension. And then the fact that He has come and chosen to take up residence in us, what a glorious thought that is. And the third thing is that because He cared that much about us, He paid a great price for us. That's the last statement. There was a great purchase of our bodies. Paul uses an Old Testament and a New Testament picture there for us. The Old Testament is of the temple. And the word he uses for temple is like the Holy of Holies, the innermost part of the temple. Where in the Old Testament, as the children of Israel were moving through the desert and then they set up the temple in Jerusalem, it was the Spirit of God dwelling in the very inner part of that temple. And you say, that's where God lives in you. Remember in 1 Corinthians 3:16 a few weeks ago, where we read, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God lives in you? Well, the verbs there were plural. And we were talking about the body of Christ. Together, God is living with us here. He's a part of the body. But here it's singular. Here it's talking about us personally. He's talking about us living here, God living in us. And then he moves to the New Testament and say, and Christ died for you so that could be possible. Jesus gave his life, paid for our sins, rescued us from the slavery to sin. Left on our own, invariably, we will wander back into a sinful lifestyle, committing sins of one kind or another. It's just all we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us, we tend to go our own way. That's the way it is. But God in Jesus Christ came and rescued us from that, both to save us and then to give us victory to live that kind of life. Glance at verse 18 for a few moments as we move to a conclusion. It's an important statement here that sets the kind of things Paul had in mind and the things that the Corinthians were dealing with and the things that are part of our life. It sets it apart. I'll read it again. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins that a man or a woman commits are outside the body. But he who commits sexual sins sins against his own body. I wish it wasn't this way. But what Paul is telling us is that sexual immorality affects us in a way that other sins don't. Of course, other sins can impact our body. When we abuse our bodies by working ourselves to exhaustion or not dealing with the stresses and our arteries get clogged up or we don't eat well or we overeat or we abuse different kinds of drugs or whatever it might be, sure, it affects our bodies. But Paul is saying that sexual immorality has a deeper effect. It's more devastating because the two become one and something happens at the deepest part of who we are. And so his answer to that is the answer of Joseph back in the Old Testament. When he was being enticed by Potiphar's wife, he fled from there. He ran from the house. And that's what Paul says here. Flee sexual immorality. So I want to conclude by saying a few things about how this might fit in our lives and pray that God will help each of us find our place in it. Hopefully you know that as pastor, I deal with the same challenges and temptations that you do. I'm tempted in this area of what we do with my body. And I would confess that probably one of my most frequent sins is not keeping a real Sabbath, not taking time to rest as I should. And I don't always honor God with my body in that area, just as one example. I just want to say, I think this passage is timely for us. And as we read it, we might come across the word prostitute and we think, that doesn't apply to me. Why is that in there? I'll just keep reading. And yet we need to stop and realize that there are various levels in which we can prostitute ourselves, have relationships with the things of this world or things that God declares as off limits. It doesn't have to necessarily be with a literal prostitute. And so all we have to do is think about our minds and our heart's desires, and we can look down the street or we can look down the aisle or we can think about our favorite social media of choice right now and realize how frequently we are tempted in this area. I mean, what pops up on your internet? You're not careful. Immediately, I mean, there are opportunities all the time in this area. But I want to say a couple things to qualify all of this. First of all, we must be careful in the church not just to speak against sexual immorality and leave all the others, you know, kind of to cover those up. And we can't do that because God doesn't do that. We already know from two previous studies that Paul puts things like gluttony and slander and thievery and anger and all those things, he puts them at the same level as sexual immorality when he's speaking about what we once were. So we must remember that. We must remember that God has provided for us to to meet the desires of our hearts, even when it comes to the level of our sexuality. And so, just as I'm tempted as you are, my source of meeting the needs in my life and the desires with how God has made me sexually as He has you is in my marriage. And I want you to hear that Paul is not against sexual intimacy here. He is all for sexual intimacy that is reflected in God's design within the marriage. And so He blesses that. And He wants us to find the joy of our hearts in that area as well. It's important for me that you understand that we're not down, that the Bible is not down on that. God, the Bible celebrates our sexuality in many, many ways. In conclusion, I want to remind you again that our body is made up of soul and spirit, and then there's the physical part. And we just can't pull all of those things apart very easily. God has made us one. And so I want to invite you to make some commitments as we conclude this morning, starting with the area of your mind. Because I believe very much that our thoughts are the foundations of our actions. See, there's knowing and there's thinking, and then finally there is the doing. And remember the King James Version of Proverbs 23:7. The first part says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So I want you to just reflect a little bit this morning on your heart. On your thoughts. As you think, I'll say in your mind, that's what you are. Just go to prayer with me right now. And let's ask God to just open our hearts and reveal to us areas where we might need to deal with this area of our thoughts, of our minds. And ask God to give us a purity of mind, which I know is a tremendous challenge, but it's possible in Jesus. Why? Because He lives within us. He wants to take over. He wants to rule our lives. He offers to be the Lord of our minds. So right now, just let God speak to you. And you speak back to Him in your heart. What commitment could you make in the area of your mind and your thoughts? Then I want to move to the area of your heart and give you Proverbs 4:23 that says, above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Isn't that a beautiful concept? Just such wisdom there. The heart is the wellspring of life. What comes out finally is what we feed and how we pursue the desires. What are the desires of your heart? Above all else, will you ask God to help you guard your heart so that what springs forth from you is of Him and is honoring to Him? So you can honor God with your heart, with the things that you pursue, the desires of your heart. Oh, they could be so many, huh? You know what they are. You know what your desires are right now. Would you just offer them over to God right now? Would you just give them to God? Say, God, I give you the desires of my heart. They are not my own. Just as my body is not my own, just as Paul says, you are not your own, the desires of my heart, they are not my own. God, I give them to you. Ask God to help you to seek after Him. To say with David, one thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. To gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. In other words, I want to be in God's presence always. So that my desires, my heart's desires, are in line with His. And then finally, let's just take a moment to think about our bodies, our physical bodies. What I'm thinking here about is the things that we do that flow out of our mind and out of our heart. And finally, it comes to what Paul says at the end of this chapter. You are bought with a price. Honor God with your body. Would you ask God to give you victory right now in that area of what you do with your body? Maybe in the area of exercise. For you, it may be the area of your diet. And you know that you're not eating in a way that really honors your body or honors God with your body. Maybe rest. Maybe you're working almost 7 days a week. You're going to leave here and you're going to go back to work. And you know that you don't have a pace of life that honors God. It could be a whole bunch of things. It could be a need for rest. Could be something that you're abusing that's so available today. I don't know what your drug of choice is, if it's caffeine or soda or some kind of booze or drugs. Would you ask God to give you victory in that area? Honor God with your body. Women, would you make a commitment this morning to honor God with your fashions? It's just an area that you could honor God and you could honor us men if you would just make a commitment to modesty in terms of your dress, not go along with everything that's just fashionable today. I think that's part of this text. Honor God with your body. Everything is permissible, not everything is beneficial. And then finally, God has made us sexual beings, and we have desires and appetites. Will you commit yourself to finding your needs met in your home, in your marriage, if you're a married person? And for those of you who are single, that you would honor God as well and ask Him to meet the desires of your heart only. God, we acknowledge this morning that we're not our own. We often live like it. We often act like it. We often go for days acting like we're in charge. When as believers in particular, You dwell in us by Your Holy Spirit. What a sacredness that gives. Not to worship our bodies, but to care for them and respect them in all areas and all that we do. Lord, I am trusting Your Holy Spirit to bring this message into our hearts and to where it needs to find a home. I can't mention everything this morning, but Your Holy Spirit is unlimited. And so just speak. Convict, if that's necessary. Encourage. After all, You are a God who says that if we confess our sins, You're faithful, You're righteous, You'll forgive us our sins. You'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a great truth to end on this morning, God. That in Jesus Christ we have freedom, we have forgiveness, and we have the victory. We praise You. Let's stand together and sing the song of commitment. Make it real, make it your song this morning.
Times of hope.
Well, I realize that was a little heavy. Why don't you all just take a deep breath and smile at the person next to you to know that God is good. God loves us, and we can go from here with great joy today. I want to give you this blessing. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with every good thing for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen. Go in peace. God bless you.